What is up, everyone? Welcome to the bonus episode for Let's Play Bayonetta 2. We're continuing our 100% completion run of Bayonetta 2. Anything you didn't see in the main playthrough will be shown off here. So to start the video off, I'm going to be showing off costumes first, including the Nintendo ones and the special features they possess, plus some really cool costume-related Easter eggs. I'm going to show off all of the unlockable weapons. Then from there, we'll move on to cleaning up all the remaining Umbran Crows that I missed in the main playthrough. Then we'll really start digging into the good stuff with the secret unlockable ultra-difficult boss fight. And then from there, we'll go to take a look at Tag Climax, plus the playable unlockable characters in Tag Climax. And then we'll cap things off with the Lost Witch Trials, chapters 1 through 5. So, not really a costume, but first off, there's Rosa. She's an unlockable character you get for beating Third Climax difficulty. We'll see more of Rosa later on. Right now, I'm just cycling through all of Bayonetta's unlockable costumes you get from the shop. We'll get to the good ones in a second. I actually really like that red and black outfit right there. We have the Metal Witch. We have the dress from the beginning and the end of the game, dress A and B. And here are the fun ones. So we have them in the new hairstyle, and you can also get them in the old hairstyle, along with just the original Bayonetta 1 version of Bayo. All of these Nintendo costumes, though, they have special properties. So first off, the Mushroom Kingdom Princess costume replaces all of your Wicked Weaves with Bowser's limbs. You probably saw that in the original trailer for Bayonetta 2 when they announced it was being bundled with Bayo 1. The other cool thing about this costume is it turns all of the halos into coins from Mario. And when you pick those coins up, you get the Mario coin sound effect. Oh god, these are so good. So next up, the Hero of Hyrule costume. We also have Sharaba, which is an unlockable weapon returning from the first game. You get it after you buy the Super Mirror, and it turns into the Master Sword when you use the Hero of Hyrule costume. In addition to that, the other special function of this costume is that you can parry using the Hylian Shield, which means you don't have to equip the Moon of Mahakala in order to pull off parries. And it also turns halos into rupees with the accompanying sound effect. And you get that, which I love. When you find secrets or you open a chest, you get the corresponding Zelda sound effect. I still feel like Bayonetta in Link's costume should turn Diomedes into Epona. And next we have the Metroid costume, the Galactic Bounty Hunter costume. With the arm cannon, you can charge it up, and it actually does quite a lot of damage. It pushes enemies back. Beast Within turns you into the Morph Ball, and you can lay down bombs in that form. Oh, and the sound effect is so good. And you also get the Screw Attack as your double jump. These costumes are too damn good, man. And then finally, the Galactic... Star Mercenary, Star Fox. Your guns are replaced with little R-Wing guns. You get the cool little targeting reticle. You charge it up just like the Galactic Bounty Hunter one. And you also get some cool Easter eggs, which, if you haven't seen them before, you might go berserk for. So there's this one in the prologue when Jean comes in with a jet, which turns into the R-Wing. And this one in the final chapter in the Jet Fighter Assault. It turns the Jet Fighter Assault Plane into an R-Wing for a Star Fox section. Holy shit. This one, people found almost immediately when the game came out. Everyone was losing their fucking minds over this, and for good reason. This is one of the best Easter eggs ever. So next up, we'll show off the Umbran Elegances. I think I showed one of these off very early on in the main playthrough. The one for Kafka, which turns you into kind of a little Fletcher or Robin Hood getup. They're little visual accoutrements that accompany certain weapons. Before I go further, though, I should probably play this cutscene.
Hold on a sec. Where'd you get your hands on that? All different kinds of golden LPs, you know. But that one you got right there is a very special one. My hands are shaking just looking at it. All of Inferno's gonna lose their shit when they hear this one. Don't know if I'll be able to keep them under control. Don't make me beg you, Bayonetta. Hurry up and hand it over. This one right here, this one's special. You know what to do.
We get the chain chomp from the Super Mario 64 LP, which you unlock at the end of third Climax difficulty, and it has its own Umbran elegance attached to it, which puts you in a Mario hat and the mustache. Next up, we're going to be cleaning up the Umbran Crows I missed in the main playthrough. I got crows number 1, 3, 4, 7, 11, and 19 in the main playthrough. I'll be grabbing them in order based on the ones I missed here in the video. So the second one was there in Chapter 1 near the first muspelheim. Number 5 was past the door where you fight Urbane in Chapter 4, trying to catch up. Number 6 was on the left at the beginning of Chapter 5. Number 8, it was on the outcropping near the Midas's Testament chest before the final Alfheim in Chapter 5. Number 9 there was just after Verse 2, the Hideous Hatred verse in Chapter 7. Number 10 here is in Chapter 8, just after the Gates of Hell, right before you fight the Golem on the left lip of this arena. Good, I'm caught up. Number 12 is here in Chapter 9. It's on this broken column after Verse 2 with the Malicious. Number 13 is right behind you on the glowing platform after you go through the portal in Chapter 9 following the fourth verse. Number 14, I believe we're on, is in Chapter 10. This one's really easy to miss on these floating platforms, just following Verse 2. And then the next one, number 15, is also in Chapter 10. It follows Verse 8, and it's near a muspelheim out here after you cross one of the tree or centipede bridges. Again, because the stage is red, it makes it a little bit easy to miss. Then, number... what are we on? 16 is here in Chapter 13, just before the verse in the courtyard. Same spot as in Bayonetta 1. 17 can be a pain in the ass. This is also in Chapter 13, after the bridge section. The thing is, the crow can phase out of existence and refuse to respawn, which forces you to exit to the title screen and continue to restart the checkpoint. There's also a checkpoint trigger nearby that can make you restart the stage if you hit it. This one took me a good couple of tries to actually get. See, here I had to reload the checkpoint by returning to the title screen and continuing. That one's annoying to get. Number 18 is once again in Chapter 13. This is just after the Golem Wall following Grace and Glory. And it's up on the windowsill on the left back there. Finally, number 20 is in the final chapter on the left as you follow Balder up the stairs. And that is all 20 Umbran Crows. Okay, now let's fight Rodin. Normally, this costs one Halo shy of 10 million, but the refight's free.
I'm not one to talk shit. But you might be biting off more than you can chew, you dig? What the hell? Been a while since you and I threw down. But real talk, I've been waiting for this for ages. You ready? Let's do this.
Alright, Rodin. This is one of the hardest boss fights I've ever encountered. It is jaw-droppingly hard. And it's awesome. It's also a tremendously fair fight. Feels really, really good. I used Rosa for this. She's a glass cannon. I'm gonna die in 1 to 2 hits, maybe 3 in this form. Bayonetta only takes a couple more hits than that, and Rosa deals significantly higher damage, so it's worth being glass cannon here. You kind of want to aim for perfection. Even though I did take a hit, you kind of want to play this as tightly as possible. Otherwise, you really don't stand a chance. I also took advantage of Umbran Spear here to close the distance a lot and maximize damage. Umbran Spear is the one where you double tap the left trigger. It's got some wonky tracking, but it did way more good than bad. Also, there's an accessory called Eternal Testimony, which keeps you at 2 magic minimum. So you always have 2 orbs of magic, so you can spam any moves like the spear that use it. He has a grab that you saw him try to do. He lands it later in the fight. It brings you to 1 HP. If he lands it a second time, it'll kill you outright. I've been shooting the whole time to make his AI react more aggressively, because when he's nonstop aggressive, it's easier to predict his attacks. When he takes a break and when he staggers moves, as fast as they come out, you don't want to be reacting to him. You want to make him easier to predict if possible. In the first phase, you can stagger him in Witch Time and break his combos. In phase 2, you cannot. The nice thing about that, though, is in Witch Time, you can see him winding up in slow motion, and it makes dodging the subsequent hits in a combo much easier. You just have to nail the first hit in a combo, and you're okay. I can't emphasize how fast Rodin is, by the way. It's unreal. He only gets faster as the fight progresses, too. This fight was real sloppy. I am happy with some of these parries, though. Some of them were out of this world, and I wasn't fishing for them either. I considered restarting when I got hit the first time, but I decided not to just so I could get the kill recorded. I've since gone on to pure plat him, but I wasn't super happy with how this fight went. I wind up cheesing him out right here, using her Umbran Climax, which turns her into the armor. You cannot be killed while the armor's active. And I have enough magic stocked up that I can keep it active till the end of the fight. Something a lot of people do here is they use the Bracelet of Time and activate Witch Time manually with it. And then by the time you get to his demon form, you've stocked up so much magic that you can keep Witch Time activated indefinitely.
Credit where credit is due. You just put your foot straight up my ass. You won this time. But remember, the devil always gets his due.
If you want a real practical example of how fast Rodin is, I counted the frames on some of his moves. His uppercut there, in demon form towards the end of the fight, 6 frames of animation. In a 60 FPS game, that's 1/10 of a second, and you lose half your health if you don't somehow manage to avoid it. His dive kick from neutral up in the air to hitting you is about 9 to 11 frames of animation, somewhere around there, about a 1/6 of a second. The average human reaction time is, what, 260 milliseconds? Yeah, Rodin is real, real fast. The single most important piece of advice I can give for that fight, if you're trying to learn him, is there's no magic trick to him. The only thing you can do is fight him until you know every one of his moves and his behavior patterns instinctively, because he becomes way too fast to react to. You need to bait him into attacks and anticipate them rather than reacting to them. Even if you somehow are fast enough to react, if you have the fastest possible reflexes, you need to make dozens of correct reactions over the course of the fight to get through it if you're trying to do it that way. It's much easier to learn his patterns flat out and anticipate what's coming and bait him into things. Next up, though, we're going to play some Tag Climax. You got a little spoiler ahead of time, but Rodin is playable in Tag Climax along with the Masked Lumen Sage, and we're fighting Labilis, who, as far as I know, is not fightable anywhere else in the game. This is the replacement summon for Gamora in this game. It's not a terribly intricate fight, but it's pretty cool that you can see all of Labilis, and it's cool that you can fight him as just a standalone boss in this mode. So this is the co-op mode of the game. You use verse cards that we've been selecting and picking up throughout the game. Each one is for a different monster or a different boss. You play through six verses in Tag Climax with a CPU or a player partner. Each verse is a card, so like you have Accolades or Malicious or Labilis there, or whatever. You can bet halos on a verse, and the more halos you bet, the harder the verse gets, but the better the payout for the verse. It's really easy to make money that way. Not as easy as using the Gaze of Despair and the Bracelet of Time on the Witch Hunts chapter to farm, where you can get like 2 million halos per run. You and your partner have your own halo counters based on your combo score. The winner of a verse gets a bonus. There's also this rainbow Mobius symbol that goes over enemies that both you and your partner are focusing on together, and it builds up this gauge, which is like a shared Umbran Climax gauge. If one of you goes down, the other one has to pick the partner up. What else? Cards are collected in story mode, and for doing some other stuff. There are 53 in total. Some of them are hidden, like Rodin's, for instance. As you do Tag Climax, some bosses will randomly challenge you, and if you beat them, you will unlock their card, and some of them you can also unlock as playable characters in Tag Climax, like Rodin and the Masked Lumen Sage here. And Rodin is kind of hard to get used to using. He's fun, he's not very mobile though. He also doesn't have an evade. Instead, he gets the short temporary shield, which acts as a block. He's a hard hitter, immobile as hell. Hard to get used to. The Masked Lumen Sage, however, I really, really enjoy using him. I wish he was playable in the main campaign, but alas, you only get Bayo, Jean, and Rosa for the main campaign. So finally, we come to the Lost Chapters, which is essentially Bloody Palace, whatever you want to call it. You run a gauntlet. You don't have any restorative items or any of your lollipops available to you. You usually get a small or a large green laurel between verses, so you recover a little bit of health between verses. The difficulty of the chapters increases, and the difficulty of each of them is fixed, so you can't select, like, if you're having trouble with one of the chapters, you can't bump it down. They're fixed difficulties. Chapter 1 and 2 are pretty easy, 3 is a lot tougher, 4 is pretty hard, 5 is really tough. If you fail at any point in a chapter, you have to start from the beginning. As you can see, these are pretty long, and I don't have that much to say about them, except Chapter 5, which we're still a ways away from. We're verse 2 in Chapter 1. Chapter 5, though, is dog shit. I hate Chapter 5. It could have been great, but nah. The rest of them are pretty good. I like Chapters 1 through 4. Chapter 5 has maybe 2 or 3 really fun verses, and several which are extremely shitty. One of the big problems with Chapter 5 is you get big enemies paired together. Like, at one point you fight two Valors in the same arena, and the arena is very small, which makes the camera go nuts. And then some of the enemy combinations aren't great. They overlap, like, and stagger their attacks in an annoying way. And it's on Infinite Climax, so it's really, really unforgiving. Be forewarned, in Chapter 5, I got real, real cheesy with that chapter using the Bracelet of Time, and I have no regrets about that. I hate that chapter. It's not pretty. The thing about it is, it doesn't feel fun. Like, yeah, it's hard, but Rodin was a lot harder, and I had a blast with him. And, like, when I say my jaw dropped fighting Rodin, I'm not making that up. When I was making my initial attempts on him, he destroyed me so hard that my jaw literally dropped for a while. It was intense. I went in thinking that I was prepared for him. Like, I've been playing character action games for a really long time. I've beaten Bayonetta 1 on Nonstop Infinite Climax 2 different times. I beat Hard and Infinite Climax on Bayonetta 2. I've beaten Rodin in the first game. I thought I was ready. I thought I was prepared. I was not fucking ready by a long shot. It was... I wish I recorded some of those earlier attempts, because that was one of the most one-sided, most vicious ass-whoopings I've ever received in a game, hands down. Like, it's not even fair to say he whooped my ass. It doesn't do it justice. He mauled me like a bear. And then you get to phase two after you adjust to phase one. It's like, oh, you got used to that first form before Demon Rodan came out? Double time. And he just gets faster as the fight progresses. And not just by a little bit, by huge, huge margins. On the last bit of health, he's zipping around the arena like a goddamn fighter jet if you let him. And you know how, like, with most bosses, you pop Umbran Climax and it's like a couple of seconds of free damage, totally unimpeded? It's like you activate it and the boss goes, whoops, you found my weakness. Rodan's having none of that. Umbran Climax will not do that for you. You activate it and he carries on giving approximately zero fucks. And it's amazing. Rodan is so good. It's like, Rodan's such a great fight. And Chapter 5 is way, way less challenging than that, but way more annoying and not nearly as fun. Aside from just shit-talking Chapter 5 of the Witch Trials, or the Lost Witch Chapters, whatever they're called, Bloody Palace, aside from that, I don't have that much to say about it. So for once, I'm gonna shut up for the remainder of this until all 5 Lost Chapters are done, so that's gonna be a while. I'll see you at the end of Chapter 5.
Let's go. Thank you. like my new haircut?
Come on. Thank you. Like my new haircut?
Okay, that's Witch Trial 5 completed. That's all 5 lost chapters. Now it's just time to do a little bit of cleanup and go through all of my spoils.
Diplomacy has failed. Thank goodness capitalism still has its place in hell. Let's do business.
Yeah, another diplomacy's failed. So I just went through the gates of hell real quick to show off that I got literally everything, including the immortal marionette, which you have to complete easy to get. I figured the difficulties would just stack, so I would get it at the end of the normal difficulty playthrough, but no, I had to do a separate first climax difficulty playthrough to get the immortal marionette. And then I also did my infinite climax playthrough and got all my techniques, got literally everything there is to get from the shop. Yeah, and there's the platinum ticket. Now all that's left to do is check out the gallery. See what kind of concept art and what kind of cool stuff we unlock throughout the course of the game. I don't think I showed this off at the end of Bayonetta 1. The world of Bayonetta 2. Oh, that reminds me. Udon is eyeing the Bayonetta 2 art book that comes out this month in Japan. They're eyeing it to translate it. I hope that comes out soon. I just finally got my my Eyes of Bayonetta 1 that's been sold out on Amazon for the longest time. That just arrived the other day. I haven't even flipped through that. I haven't even popped that DVD in yet that came with it. I'm really looking forward to The Eyes of Bayonetta 2. Get some really astounding looking concept art here. The one that I really want to see is that the concept art for the the name is escaping me. Glamour? I really want to see that watery tornado concept art. Yeah, and you get all the 3D models, you get lots of cool stuff here. And then finally, let's take a quick look at the Umbran Tears of Blood. Bam, 30 bewitchments out of 30, and 20 crows collected out of 20, for a total of 50 Umbran Tears of Blood. Some of these were kind of annoying to get. The Undying one, where you have to freeze a whole bunch of unique enemy types, like 40 unique enemy types you have to freeze with Undying, yeah, that was a pain in the ass. Anyway, there you have it. 100% completion of Bayonetta 2. I've said it before, and I'll say it again, Bayonetta 2 improves upon perfection in a big bad way. But that is where this playthrough ends. The bonus episode is now done. We've shown everything there is to show. So I'll just say this. Once again, thanks for watching, everyone. Take it easy. Have a good one.